Hi guys. Well, today gives me great pleasure to have Larry here from Beyond Payments, one of our partners at the Coffee Commune, doing some amazing work in the whole FPOS space and payment space. So Larry, welcome.
Thank you, Phil.
Tell me, let's kick off. Tell us a little bit about what you guys are doing at Beyond Payments.
So Beyond Payments is specialized in on charging fees in the FPOS space, originally in-store. Now we're across all payment mediums, gateways, in-store. Like, payments market's really grown substantially. But originally we started the business around the guidelines with on-charging, surcharging, which was a really murky space when we started. There were very few who did it compliantly, especially small businesses. It was a minefield for small businesses. The banks made it really hard for merchants to read their merchant statements and know how to compliantly on-charge. So we took on that challenge to try and make it really easy for them to on-charge their fees in a fair and compliant way. And that's how Beyond Payments came about.
So what's, tell me, in short, what's the biggest problem you solve for small business? Because small business is time poor, they don't have a lot of knowledge, as you said, and there's a lot of changes that happen with stuff. Explain to us what problem, in short, do you solve for the small business operator?
Well, initially, it was really around trying to reduce costs. A lot of small merchants felt that they had to absorb those fees. It was sort of an unwritten rule, for want of a better word, that whatever banks charged customers to use their cards had to be embedded in products. And as costs went up in small businesses, as we all know, labor costs, rental costs, costs of produce, merchant fees was this one line item that kept growing, especially because of the convenience of tap and go.
Yes.
Merchant fees went through the roof. The issue that we saw was that many cards had rewards, interchange costs, and these were all being lumped into sort of one interchange cost around these merchant fees, and we tried to eliminate that cost in a fair way, educating our merchants on how to differentiate between different cards and then compliantly on charging those costs.
Okay. And therefore saving people money, right?
Absolutely.
And not just directly money, but saving them book fees and all that sort of stuff, right?
Well, I think that what's happened is, as the space has evolved, is originally the Reserve Bank allowed people to on charge these costs, but tried to give guidelines around it. And then as they saw that certain merchants weren't doing it in a fair manner, together with consumer law, what we try to do is say, yes, we want to save you money, but we don't want to lose your customers. We don't want to give you a bad customer experience.
Yeah.
So we wanted to, at the same time, educate customers to say, you can choose which card you want to pay with or pay with cash.
Yes.
It's still an option,
Even
though we live in a cashless society.
Unfortunately, some operators don't take it, but
exactly.
Different discussion.
But there are many different cards. I think a lot of people don't understand that you have, within the Visa network and within the MasterCard network, up to 20 or 25 different cards that all incur different underlying fees.
That's a good point. There's, over 20, 25 different cards and people don't know. So tell us, who'd be your biggest competition in the space?
Oh, most definitely still the banks.
The banks, yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I think there are now emerging and have in the last 5 or 6 years many more independent players. But, for some reason, people still trust the banks, believe in the banks. It's the most seamless way of getting an FPOS terminal, because you open a bank account, you get an FPOS terminal. But the banks will never take on that underlying risk. They'll give you a one-line item of your average cost of acceptance, which people believe is fair to pass on. But they'll never take the risk of all the underlying interchange and terminal rental costs like certain other providers out there.
So why Beyond Payments and not the banks?
Well, I think it's exactly really what we're talking about. We care about small business. We understand all of the complexities that come with running a small business. We want to simplify that process. So we do take on all of that risk. We give them one blended rate that includes all costs. So when they do on charge, and they'll give different card types a different on charge, so whether it's debit or credit or FPOS, they can have that option to say to the merchant, you can pay, you can choose which card you want to pay with, and that card will incur generally a different rate So we will pass on a different rate and give you that. So we do the signage. It's really from start to finish, the customer experience, but also taking those fees out of the business.
And you get total transparency, right? Well,
exactly. That's exactly right. And I think that's the difference, really. When you talk about transparency, that's the cornerstone of what our business does. And probably the biggest difference, I believe, between what we do and some of the what the big institutions do, you just don't get that transparency.
Yeah, I'd love to pick your brain on something that it's a bit of my bugbear. Is the, of course, the banks charge the shopholder, so let's say the cafe, the shop, the banks charge the cafe an FPOS fee, but they charge it on a debit card transaction and they charge on a credit card transaction, right? And, you know, the credit card I get because it's not your money, but the debit card where it is your money, you know, my stance on it is they shouldn't be allowed to be charging account fees, monthly account fees to have an account with the bank and then be charging the cafe owner who then passes on to me to be using my own money. And I'm sure all the listeners and yourself have seen that $50 note that mem that went around where $50 starts as $50 but quickly comes down to be worth $48 and then $47 and then $45. And as it goes over the lifespan of a transaction, $50 comes down to zero. But on the bank account, to the banks, it goes up. So, you know, $50 is not $50 when you're getting charged a fee, right?
Absolutely, Phil. And I think that one of the things that surprises me, and I shouldn't be surprised after over 10 years in the business, but how many merchants I go to who just don't know how to read their merchant statement.
Yeah.
Because they are so complex and there are so many different charges when it comes to interchange plus rates, the actual bank rate, debit cards, FPOS. I mean, this morning I was with a merchant of ours trying to explain the difference between the FPOS rails and debit cards and how you can choose different rails to run cheaper transactions down. It's a complex space. You're right. You know, when someone uses their debit card, it could be a savings account, check account. We don't call them those anymore, transaction account. But yes, it is their money. But when they choose a Qantas rewards card, for example, or any rewards card for that matter, there's a much higher interchange cost to that card. I think the big point about that is, why should a merchant incur the costs of a customer choosing to transact in a certain way?
Correct.
That's the mindset that we come from, which a lot of people don't understand.
Well, and you're very pro-business, which is a great thing, and that's why you're having great success helping people. So get a hold of Beyond Payments if you need that help, because as Larry said, it's not a line item anymore. It's actually got to be a budgeted expense, because if you have a look at your statement and see how much you're actually paying at the end of the year and the different rates and all the rest of it. And for you, what I love about what you're doing, Larry, is you specialise in this field. This is your area of specialty, whereas for a bank, it's just one of many products. You know, it makes them a lot of money, but it's one of many products, whereas you actually specialize in this and helping especially small business excel. So we love that. Tell me some great success stories. You know, you don't have to mention their names and all the rest of it, but where have you had some really good success that stands out?
I think, Phil, it's as you say, it's hard to mention one specifically, you know, but there is actually a little coffee shop in Brisbane where it probably took me 6 months of going to that particular coffee shop. She was somewhere around the corner from our gym that I used to go to coffee often, and I would see her bank terminal giving her trouble. And she just couldn't get in her head that she'd on-charge the fees. You know, she didn't want to do it. And I assured her that 5 cents extra on a cup of coffee. And it's funny, often the merchants who don't want to surcharge are also the cheapest.
Yeah.
You know, you go to other places, they don't want to surcharge, but they'll charge $6 for a coffee as opposed to one.
So they absorb it anyway. Yeah.
It's priced in. Mm. Others are charging $4 for a coffee, but they don't want to hurt their customers. Hospitality is all about caring about their customers. Anyway, eventually I talked to her through service. I talked to her how we give options to customers, and she went down that route and she was able to buy a new van to distribute coffee,
isn't that good?
You know, which was just, it changed their business life in terms of being able to grow the business to another level.
It's thousands.
Absolutely.
Thousands of dollars. Yeah. So if you're listening to this and you own a business and you haven't checked out or know what your number is, make sure you do. And if you need any help around it, the guys at Beyond Payments, that's what they specialize in, is there to help you accelerate your potential. And that's why we love having them part of the coffee commune. Tell me, you know, if you could change one thing in your industry, what would it be?
It's a hard question, that, you know, but I'm trying to think what would be the most
The regulation? Is it because of the regulation or the lack of regulation?
I think there's too much regulation in this country, to be honest, in certain spaces, you know. But I think people have this fear of the big institutions, you know, that if they leave, they don't trust smaller businesses. And sometimes, you know, with good reason. But it's very difficult to compete, you know, with the big institutions. They sort of have this fear and trust of them, even though a lot of the smaller merchants know that they're not necessarily getting the best deal, you know. But I don't know if it would necessarily change our industry, but they just seem to dominate the space with small merchants not asking the right questions about why they should be with them.
I think the key there is, Larry, that a lot of people obviously just go through the motions. You know, they go, okay, well, I've got a bank account with one of the big four, or might be a local Bendigo or whatever. So I'm going to do everything with them, and don't realise that you can actually chop and change. Even banks, I mean, and I'm guilty of this one, you know, where we go, right, because I'm with one bank, I'm going to do everything with that one bank. Whereas you talk to others and you get maximum efficiency by actually scoping out one bank for private banking, one bank for commercial banking, and the rest of it.
So. And that is my fear for exactly what you're saying, and it is happening in our industry, is that you are getting certain sort of point of sale providers that are now going into payments and forcing the providers to go down their payment route. So they're adding payments on their not payment specialists, and they sort of forcing the payments upon those smaller merchants who don't know that they do have other options and it's too hard to change. Maybe that is where the regulator should
step. Yeah, I was going to say that's probably where they should, because that's a bit of bullying tactics, right?
Absolutely.
Or they're holding people to ransom.
Yep. And even the banks do that to a certain extent, because they can make accounts, they can make money transactionally with their accounts and force people to stay with them or their boss. That's something we've battled for 10 years.
Yeah.
You know, where I think merchants should have choice.
Well, that's the key message there, right? Is that merchants do have a choice, but they need to make sure that they, you know, operators have choice of merchants, and you've got to exercise that choice. Do, you know, research and explain. It's one of the reasons why we do these series as well, is to tell people what's out there and what's available, because people are still learning. The number one problem we find right now, we know now after researching 9,000 bits of data in 2023, is that the number one problem is actually operators. People are not skilled to operate. And that includes things like not embracing technology or not knowing what technology is out there or what businesses like Beyond Payments are out there to help them operate their business. So that's why we love shining a light on our partners and what you guys are doing, so that we can get the message out there to all of our members, which is over 500-600 cafes now, plus all other members, and growing. So we love that. And thank you, obviously, for your time.
Yeah, and I think that if I can say one thing about the Coffee Commune that I absolutely love, is being a champion of small business. Is to get that education into the smaller, medium sizes, which is really the backbone of our economy.
It is.
The biggest employer in the country.
In the country, yeah.
And just let them, you know, our biggest challenge is getting a merchant statement out of a small business. They just don't want to go down that road with us. You know, once we do and show them how complex it is and what we can do for them, and not be fearful of on-charging their fees when it is in a compliant manner.
Yeah.
You know, that is not, it's not for everyone, obviously, but I often, and you know, touching on what you said earlier, is the misinformation from the media is probably what gets me the most, is they have this blanket approach of don't surcharge, you know, and all these surcharge rates are too high. And it's just not true. Surcharge rates are actually coming down, and being able to go out and give customers choice means there's pressure on the big card schemes to push down their fees. So if you look at the States, for example, where surcharging is not allowed, Visa and MasterCard dominate the market, and fees are as high as 3%.
Yeah, well, Amex used to be 3%, and they had
been,
to drop.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So they've been forced to drop because we've seen surcharge have a real impact on their value proposition. And that's what we want. We don't want to surcharge and want fees to go up.
Yes.
We want to surcharge and fees to come down.
Yeah,
that's exactly what we want, because that's good for small business.
Yeah, and that's why I love what you guys are doing. And you know, to put it in context, the cafe owners that are listening to this will tell you, most of them aren't even making 3% profit right now. They're just treading water and breaking even, right?
Yeah.
And if they're lucky enough, they might be making single-digit profits, which is around 7 to 9%. Gone are the days at the moment where it was 20, 25% profit. So back then, you could absorb an extra 1 or 2%. Now, every percent matters. So what you guys are doing has big impact, and I encourage the listeners, again, get those statements out, talk to people like Larry at Beyond Payments, and show them your statements, let them help you interpret what it's costing and what you could save, and how you could do merchant fees and, you know, the whole FPOS system and payment system better in general.
And I think, Phil, you know, one of the things that I'm starting to see now, which is probably the single biggest change in the FPOS space, and it's probably where the smaller fintechs are starting to have a slight advantage on the bigger places, is that terminals are getting smarter. We're moving into an Android and sort of Android era, if you want, where there are apps on the terminals. We can tokenize cards now, so you can actually see how your merchants shop and behave.
Yeah.
So there's an opportunity not only to save money, but to create a value proposition in the small cafes.
To grow your business.
Exactly. And that's what we're really excited about. That's probably the next phase of where we're going.
And funny enough, the second part of the study that we did in 2023, that we're releasing the data this year and doing all our workshops around, is exactly that, is that people have to, they don't know how to market their business to grow their customer base. We're living in an era now where you can't sell more to less people, because the disposable income's come down. So now we're in an era, and the first time in about 10 to 12 years, where you've got to expand your customer base because they're all spending less. And that's a completely different strategy. Yes. So, you know, that space is exciting for many reasons. And obviously that's a big problem that you guys can help solve, is helping people get more business through their doors.
Yeah, I'm really excited about that, because it's now not only about saving money, but it's also about how we can grow the value proposition to the customers already coming into your store.
Love it.
You know, so that's an exciting.
Well, Larry,
space.
Thanks for joining us. Thanks for being part of the Commune. We love the fact that you're part of our family, and you know, and hope we see you grow, and you'll grow by helping other people obviously save money and grow their business as well. So
that's what we love doing.
Well done. Thank you.
Thank you.